Jay Onrait brought to you by our friends at McDonald's. Big day in sports on Tuesday. We're going to get to those two all-Canadian matchups in just a little bit. And the Raptors were in action as well. But the latest now on Tiger Woods, who has suffered a shattered ankle and two leg fractures this morning. That would be Tuesday morning in a car accident. One of them a compound fracture. According to the LA County Sheriff's Department, he is lucky to be alive. And the accident, a single car crash that happened around 7 a.m. Pacific time. Woods, the only person in the vehicle. The car sustained serious damage, hitting the center median, the curb, a tree, rolled several times. Tiger was alert and conscious when emergency services arrived on the scene, who had to extricate him from the wreck through the car's windshield. Crash happened outside LA near a course where Tiger was filming a documentary. Cause of the crash still unknown. However, there has been no evidence of any impairment. According to the LA Times, Woods was traveling at a high rate of speed and lost control of the vehicle. LA County Sheriff's Department said it's a downhill road with a big curve. The area has a high volume of accidents.
Today at 7:12 in the morning, Lomita Sheriff's Station received a call of a solo vehicle collision in Hawthorne Boulevard, north of Palos Verdes Drive. We arrived on scene at 7:18 a.m. and discovered a solo vehicle collision, and the sole occupant was, again, Tiger Woods. And deputies, at the time, they did not see any evidence of impairment, anything that of concern. Obviously, the life-saving measures that had to be taken for the occupant of the vehicle. No skid marks, no braking. So apparently, the first contact was with the center median, and from there then cross into the opposing lane of traffic, hit the curb, hit a tree, and there was several rollovers during that process. The time it made, it crossed the center divider to the point that it rested was several hundred feet away. So obviously that indicates they were going at a relatively a greater speed than normal. However, because it is downhill, it slopes, and it also, it curves, that area has a high frequency of accidents. It's not uncommon. The interior of the cabinet of the vehicle was more or less intact. The front end was totally destroyed. The bumpers, everything was destroyed. Airbags deployed, all of that. And however, thankfully, the interior was more or less intact, which kind of gave him the cushion to survive what's otherwise would have been a fatal crash.
Unfortunately, Mr. Woods was not able to stand under his own power. Our partners at LA County Fire were able to extricate him from the vehicle, and they put him onto a backboard. When I arrived on the scene, Mr. Woods was seated in the driver's seat. I made contact with him, and I ensured that he was able to speak to me. At that time, he seemed that as though he was still calm and lucid. I made the determination that it would be safer to wait for LA County Fire to help remove him instead of trying to remove him myself. I kept Mr. Woods calm until LA County Fire arrived on scene.
What did you do to keep him calm, Deputy?
I spoke to him.
What was the conversation? Can you share it with us, please?
I asked him what his name was. He told me his name was Tiger, and at that moment I immediately recognized him. I asked him if he knew where he was, what time of day, just to make sure he was oriented. He seemed as though he was lucid and calm.
Was he concerned about his injuries?
He didn't seem concerned of his injuries at the time, which is not uncommon in traffic collisions. Many times people tend to be in shock. It's a traumatic experience, so it's not uncommon for people to be focused on unimportant things, or even if they are in pain, they might not feel it until much later.
Did you see any injuries on anywhere other than the legs as you were just assessing him on site?
I did observe injuries. I can't speak as to the nature of the injuries. I'm not a trained medical professional, so I can't speak to that. What I can say is that he was injured, and he was successfully removed and taken to the hospital.
Yeah. Plenty of reaction Tuesday. Jack Nicklaus and his wife Barbara wishing Tiger their support and hope for a full recovery. Phil Mickelson also pulling for Tiger and his family, wishing him a full and speedy recovery. His old nemesis, Mike Weir, on Instagram saying our thoughts and prayers with Tiger Woods today. And this from Fred Ridley, chairman of Augusta National Tiger, part of the Augusta National family. News of this accident upsetting to all of us. We pray for him for his full recovery and for his family during this difficult time. Hey, even his exes are reaching out. Lindsey Vonn also tweeted, praying for TW right now, little prayer emoji. A-Rod also tweeted, praying for my brother Tiger Woods as we all anxiously await more news, thinking of him and his entire family. All right, we're joined by TSN golf analyst Bob Weeks. Bob, wow, what a story. What's your reaction been throughout the day as we've followed this story and slowly learned more details about the crash?
I guess early on it was shock and surprise like most people, and then you kind of saw the scenes and the pictures of that crash and the devastation to that car. I mean, the front end was completely ripped off. It was very scary at that point. And then you hear the extent of the injuries and the release by his agent. You know, at the end of the day, I think this could have been a lot worse, obviously. The police officer from L.A. saying that if he wasn't wearing his seatbelt, he may have died. So perhaps this is a good news, bad news kind of day. But at the end of it, I'm not sure how much more information we'll get. Tiger is a very private person when it comes to these kind of details. So it'll be interesting to see what they do release in the coming hours and days ahead.
The golf world, the sports world, Bob, the whole world has been shaken by this news. What stands out to you about the reaction from inside and outside the world of golf?
I guess just the breadth of people who have reached out and offered, you know, thoughts and prayers, and it ranges from politicians to other athletes to celebrities in the entertainment world. And I think the most impactful ones for me, though, came from his peers on the PGA Tour. And if you look at the top players right now, it's players like Justin Thomas and Tony Finau and Bryson DeChambeau. All those guys grew up idolizing Tiger Woods, and they realize that the big checks that they play for these days are really a result of Tiger Woods' popularity, and you know, no one has done more for their careers than Tiger Woods has, so they're really feeling it today.
And then, of course, Phil Mickelson, you know, his old nemesis. I mean, yeah, everybody's in Tiger's corner now, so... things have certainly changed in that department. Bob, it was just a couple of days ago, Tiger was in that broadcast booth with Jim Nantz at Riviera talking about a potential return from another back surgery, trying to get back to the Masters in April. It's incredible how golf has become the secondary story to what happened on Tuesday.
It really has. You know, I mean, I think Tiger was in a little bit of doubt as to whether or not he was going to be playing in the Masters due to that back surgery. Now, of course, we don't really care about whether he plays or not. It will be great if he is able to get up, if he is able to go and have another comeback and play some good golf. But right now, I think the more important thing is for him to get healthy, to be the parent. I mean, he's in such a good place in his life now with his two children. We saw it when he was playing with his son Charlie in that tournament a few months ago. And now I think the biggest concern is for Tiger Woods, the guy and the dad.
Well said, Bob. Our golf analyst, Bob Weeks. Thanks for this. All right, I mentioned those two all-Canadian matchups. We're going to start in Vancouver. Canucks hosting Edmonton just over a minute into this one. What happened? Bo Horvat, Canucks captain, somehow beats Mike Smith from a brutal angle. And... I don't know how that went in. That was pretty wild. Smith was looking to start the year 5-0 for the first time in his career. Horvat's sixth first period goal of the season. Then, just over 10 minutes to go in the first, Tyler Myers, big booming clapper from the former Kelowna Rocket, off Tyler Ennis' stick and in, fools Smith. Still in the first. Yeah, we're still in the opening frame. Elias Pettersson chips at home. 150th career point. 3-0 Vancouver Canucks. In there, they're both wearing the reverse retros. Second period. Here comes Connie. Stop by Thatcher Demko. Connor McDavid, 4 points and a hat trick in his last game against Vancouver. Later, Canucks cough it up again. Connor McDavid. Did he just score? They reviewed it. It was straight crossbar. 3-1 at that point. Dominic Cahoon, by the way, has both Oiler goals. Dominic Cahoon scored about a minute into the third period. They're about 3 minutes into the third, and the Oilers down 3-2 to Vancouver. Should mention, Edmonton's won 9 of their last 11 coming into this one, while the Canucks have just 2 wins in their last 11 games. And Mike Smith giving up more than 2 goals for just the second time in 6 starts this season. With a win tonight, the Oilers would win 5 straight road games for just the 7th time in team history. These teams will play again on Thursday in Vancouver. Habs and Sens. Ottawa power play in the first. It's Tim Stützle. He starts it, ends up on the tape of his roommate, Brady Tkachuk, and he'll squeak it past Carey Price. Just a couple of roomies playing hockey and scoring goals. Tkachuk scored the OT winner Sunday against Montreal. That's his seventh, all smiles. Still in the first. Tkachuk sent to the ice by Ben Chiarot. Doesn't like that, wants to go. And Chiarot's a willing combatant. Now, Tkachuk gets a real nice shot in at the end here.
He's got some unfinished business.
And 11th career fighting major. Chiarot leaking a bit. And look at the Tkachuk-Stützle exchange.
Repairs.
Just the looks. Because roommates don't even need to communicate with words. Tkachuk did take some damage here in the second. The high stick from Shea Weber. Ouch. Very AWA wrestling. Ensuing power play, 16 minutes to go, second period.
Crossy goes to White, to Brännström, in a high slot, shoot, scores! Eric Brännström's got his first, a power play goal.
That's right. Gord Miller on the call for TSN, Ottawa's first round pick in 2017, first career goal in his 40th NHL game. They take a 3-1 lead, but after Jonathan Drouin scored to cut the lead to one, Weber, big booming clapper from another former Kelowna Rocket. Beating Matt Murray. We're square through two, third period. Tyler Toffoli walks right by Brännström, and by walks I mean skates, and beats Murray for his team leading 12th of the season. Nice signing, Mark Bergevin. Montreal has their first lead. Then Tkachuk comes back and ties it at four. Bit of a weak one, I'd say. Tkachuk first multi-goal game of the season. Yeah. It's 4-4. Then, under 10 seconds to play, it appears that Ben Chiarot has gotten the ultimate revenge and scored the winner. But hang on. Ottawa challenges for goaltender interference, and after the review, it's ruled. Now, watch Brendan Gallagher, number 11. Did he impede Matt Murray's ability to make the save before the puck went in?
They'll find that out, but
therefore
we had no goal.
There you go.
The league office thought so. No goal. Claude Julien not happy, obviously. Neither is Galley. So we're up to overtime. Tied at four. Stützle turns it over. Toffoli sent in alone. Matt Murray with a beautiful pad save. One of his 32 saves on the night. This would need a shootout. Second round. Stützle. Deutschland. 19 years old. Third overall, 5-hole, big win. The Sens win their third win in four against Montreal. Here's Gallagher on the disallowed goal.
Well, he's fired up, but he's...
This play, I'm knocked on my ass. I have time to reset. Can't tell me the goalie doesn't have time to reset. The other explanation I got, okay, I'm in the blue paint. I'm working my way out of the blue paint. We've seen in that same video plenty of examples where the player's working its way out. He's pushed into the goalie, goal counted. We watch this video, the refs watch this video. For some reason, this example is different. I don't know why. To me, it's ruining the product. I don't know who's making the final call. The referees seem to think it was him. I don't know if it's going to Toronto and they're making the final call, but consistency is what we need, and we're not getting it.
Now, when you look at the video, it's hard to argue with Brendan Gallagher. How about this? In four meetings so far this season, the Sens have the Habs number. They beat them three times, the last two games past regulation, and 17 other games, not against Montreal. Ottawa just has three wins total. They'll play next March the 2nd in Montreal. The NBA's All-Star reserves were announced Tuesday, and I checked the Eastern Conference list, and no Raptors were on it. Not a single Toronto Raptor named to the All-Star team. First time that has happened since 2013. Raps taking on the Sixers last night. Toronto riding a season-high four-game win streak. One guy who did make that reserve list, Ben Simmons of Australia.
When you have players like Simmons,
he scores.
And Tobias Harris for that 44%.
Later. Simmons to the former Toronto
Simmons
Raptor, Danny Green for
Green, corner three.
Caps a 13-0 right Philly run.
Danny Green is.
Then in the second quarter,
Thybul.
Off a turnover.
Off in the steal by Bembry.
Pascal Siakam. Two of his 10 and a half. Later, Fred Van Vliet.
So he's the guy that believes that ball's going in.
He didn't make the All-Star team, but how about this? This one from the hip.
Right from the hip.
Leads to another Siakam dunk. Part of an 8-2 Raptor run. And how about Aaron Baines understanding the rules?
Once again, Baines, doesn't want to touch it. And Embiid scoops it up. And now batted away, and it works out. Baines with a slam dunk. Just the way you draw it up.
Matty.
I lost my microphone, but I got it back.
Matty,
just
losing
like
equipment.
Matt Devlin gets more and more excited as the years go on, and I love it. Third quarter off a jump ball, Norm Powell. Chased down by Ben Simmons. That looked like a hard foul. Guess what? No call on the play. No call on the play. Raps obviously in disbelief. Norm gets a little revenge. Gets that one to go. Raps cuts the lead to as little as six. Norm was teed up, by the way, but difficult to overcome the poor start. Siakam denied by Joel Embiid. Here's Norm Powell on how he was able to calm down after getting teed up after not getting that foul call.
I meditated. yeah, got my tech, was pissed off, just meditated, let it go, try not to let it bother me, because I had to get back focused and trying to help the team get a win. But I was pissed.
This is tough, man. I thought it was critical time of the game. Momentum was heading our way. It's too bad, but it happens.
Okay, this is funny stuff. I got a rip of four great NHL matchups from last night, so stay with me. We start with the Pens and Caps. Evgeny Kuznetsov is upset because his buddy Gino Malkin was firing pucks toward that net before leaving the ice and warm up. First period, Pens power play.
Now it is
Chris Letang, Jake Gensel, back to Letang, sends it on net. Guess who deflects it in? Yes, Gino. Gino Malkin.
The Penguins take a 1-0 lead.
His buddy Ovi was in the box for goaltender interference, so it's 1-0 Pens. Second period now 1-0.
Him being there, I just don't.
Pens turn it over in their own end. Kuznetsov to Connor Sherry. Third goal in five games. He's Tristan Jerry. Sherry beating Jerry. 2-1 Caps, 2-all after 40. Overtime was needed. Dmitry Orlov's shot is wide. Jerry plays it off the boards. And here come the Pens. Teddy Bluger to Kasperi Kapanen, who beats Vitek Vanacek. Kapanen's third. Pens, fourth win in five games against Washington this season and their third straight victory overall. Let's keep it going, Devils, Sabres. Mackenzie Blackwood, 24 years old, Thunder Bay native, 48th overall in 2015. Larry Brooks of the New York Post says, likely to be the tri-state area's next great goaltender. Big kid, 6'4", Jack Eichel.
Here's the shot.
Blackwood bailed out by the post there, and Taylor Hall could not get to the rebound. 5 minutes later. You know, Buffalo came in with the league's third-best power play?
Puts another one off the post.
Again, Eichel off the post. Two goals this season for Jack Eichel. That's it. None in his last seven games.
Him in a hurry.
At the end of the same power play, Rasmus Dahlin to Victor Olofsson. Six of his seven goals this season have come on the power play.
One-timer on the power play.
So it's 1-0 Buffalo. Beautiful uniforms, early third. Sam Reinhardt sends it on net. Blackwood will make the stop, but there's Rasmus Apslund. Absalom filling in for Jeff Skinner, who is a healthy scratch for a second straight game. That's a situation. That's a continuing situation. Nikita Gusev robbed by Linus Ullmark. Puck comes back to Gusev, and he scores. But you got to see the first save. Save of the year candidate. Look at Ullmark. That is incredible. Ullmark shot out ruined by Gusev, but the Sabres have the last lap. 41 saves for Ullmark. Sabres' second win over the Devils in 3 days, and they'll face each other again Thursday in Buffalo. This one was really fascinating. Blackhawks, Blue Jackets, Patty Laine, 9 career goals and a 5-game point streak against Chicago. Patty Kane, 6th in the league with 26 points. Max Domi turns it over. 2-on-0, Pugh, Suter, and Kane. Snipes, 9th of the season, beating Yunus Korpisalo, the corporal. 2nd period, Jackets power play. Laine, wow, 7th of the season. Just a laser. Then another Columbus power play. They're down by one. Again, Laine from the faceoff dot. Goes shelf. 2nd power play goal of the period. Ties it. Let's jump to the third. This is a fun game, right? I didn't lie to you. 4-3 Chicago now. Kane to Adam Boqvist. He slides it right under the bar. Play continued, but they confirmed it after a review. So for Kane, that was his 3rd assist of the game. Then Columbus down one. Laine into the slot. Oliver Bjorkstrand scores. Game is tied. Laine 3 points, 4 points for Kane. Overtime solves nothing. Everyone take a drink. Shootout. First shooter for Chicago, Alex DeBrincat. Oh, that's nifty, beating Korpisalo.
Well, pretty patient move.
Good player. Laine, chance. He's got a score. That's all. No, he cannot do it. Kane and the Blackhawks take this one. When we return, James Duffy is going to make his first appearance on the new show. And he's going to join us to talk about the Tiger Woods story from Tuesday morning. Stay tuned for that. You're watching SportsCenter with me, brought to you by McDonald's. Tiger Woods involved in a single car accident on Tuesday morning in Palos Verdes, California. Police responded to the accident at 7:12 a.m. local time. His vehicle sustained major damage. He sustained multiple leg injuries, according to his agent, Mark Steinberg. And Tiger underwent surgery on Tuesday afternoon. Let's bring in James Duffy now, who's covered Tiger at various points of his career, including his most recent major championship win at Augusta 2 years ago. It's been wall-to-wall coverage all day, all over the news networks, all over the sports networks, all over social media. It's amazing. We're happy he's okay, but when it comes to Tiger, it's much more than a sports story, isn't it?
It really is, Jay. We've been captivated by Tiger Woods since he was 2 years old and had that appearance on the Mike Douglas show. And his entire career, his entire life has been cinematic. I mean, you go back to Earl, his dad, saying he was going to be the best golfer ever at that tender young age. And a lot of dads say stuff like that, but it actually happened. He became that. He wins those 3 U.S. amateurs in a row. And I think that was the time the world sort of became fixated on him as a golfer, and it brought in golf fans who never followed the sport. Here's a predominantly white sport, and suddenly you have a young man with a mom from Thailand and a father who's African American, and we just never seen it before. And we'd never seen the way he dominated the sport and his confidence and how he kept coming through in the clutch. And it's just, it's crazy how these interruptions have all come with him behind the wheel. When the first one in 2009, after the incident with Elon and the small crash in his neighborhood that leads to his divorce and the entire scandal there, he comes back from that and then behind the wheel again from the DUI, and now a third time. It's not a movie. It's a series. It's a Netflix series. We saw the 2-part documentary, and now you could do several more. I think he's just been the most fascinating character in sports of our lifetime.
It is amazing, James, because you're right. At the end of that 2-part doc, which I believe you can stream on Crave right now, at the end of that doc, you know, he wins the Masters. You're thinking, okay, that's it. He's never going to have any more problems. He's figured it out, and here we are again. And we don't know whether there'll be another comeback after this, but for you, you have had a chance to cover him a ton. That 2019 Masters win, where would you put that on the list of things that you've covered or that you've witnessed live? Where does it stand for you?
I would say it's probably 1A. I always go back to the Olympics, only because I got to cover it with you in 2010.
That was fun.
And you were in the hotel room next to me. And we never saw each other because you were on early in the morning. But,
that's right.
You know, the Crosby goal and having the Olympics in Canada, I'll always say is number one. But Tiger's win in 2019 is probably 1A. I got to cover him early in his career, his Masters win in 2002, which was in the middle of Tiger Mania and the height of his career. But this moment, Jay, a lot of people ask me, where were you when Tiger won? And the reality of what we do at the Masters, I end up watching the last few holes on TV because you can't cover the Masters on the golf course. But we walked the first in the front nine with him. And there was a moment he made this great two-putt on nine, and he was walking to the 10th tee. And the hysteria of that crowd, which I'd seen before with Tiger, but I think it was the realization of people that Tiger was in contention again in the back nine at the Masters, and it seemed so surreal. And I'm walking with this crowd who's all running to get into position on the 10th tee, and there's, you know, 70-year-old men and 60-year-old women screaming at the top of their lungs, like the place was on fire, because they just, it's something about him and his charisma that does something to people that I, besides maybe Michael Jordan, I've never seen an athlete do.
I will say this, if we get another comeback after this incident, they might have to add a third part to that Tiger documentary. Again, streaming on Crave. Thanks, buddy.
No problem, Jay.
Draw 10 at the Scotties. It's Jennifer Jones continuing her quest for an incredible seventh Scotties title. He's just one win to pass Colleen Jones for the most games won in Scotties history, taking on Sarah Hill's Newfoundland Labrador rink. Seventh then Manitoba down 4-3. Jones with hammer. Needs just a bit of that 8 foot, and she's going to get it. She's going to tie it up at four. And then after Manitoba took the lead with the steal, Hill with hammer in the 10th facing one. Needs the 8 foot for the win. Rex on the guard. Steal a one for Manitoba. They win at 6-5. So Jennifer Jones, the record for the most Scotties wins all time. Jennifer, if you wouldn't mind, could you just pose next to this sign? Can you continue to pose there? Just a little longer, please. Thank you. And okay, we're done.
This would definitely not be possible if I didn't curl with outstanding people and players. Like, I've just been so fortunate to have the best human beings as teammates that have supported me throughout the last, I don't even know how many years. So always them. And then obviously my parents, my dad always loved the records. He always followed all the records. It was a big, he knew exactly where we were at. And so I know he would be watching from above, very, very proud.
Another new suggestion for a new name for the Jannies. This one comes to us from viewer Nolan Bradley, who is obviously a big Harry Belafonte fan. It's J-O's. Hey-O's. I'll take it.
Once again,
Aaron Baines.
Baines, doesn't want to touch it.
This is very impressive from Baines, just to have the wherewithal to not touch the ball, then eventually get it back, and then eventually score. Not sure what happened initially, though. T-Wolves and Bucks. Giannis Antetokounmpo. Going to throw it down over Karl-Anthony Towns. He gets a technical for staring him down. Knicks Warriors.
13 seconds.
Derrick Rose to Nerlens Noel.
Well thrown, well finished.
Over Damon Lee and the foul. Derrick Rose. Great to see him still playing and still playing well. Pens and Caps. Pittsburgh D-man John Marino sends it on net. The tip from Jake Guentzel. Let's watch it again. Oh yeah, that's beautiful. Isn't that gorgeous? Oh, that's nice. Back to the cleave. Trae Young also left off the All-Star reserves. Hawks fans have reason to be upset about that. Cavs don't take a timeout. Rookie Lamar Stevens gets the game-winning dunk. That ends a 10-game losing streak for the Cleveland Cavaliers. So there you go. That's the story in the world of sports. But when we return, we're going to talk about the highlight of the night and the worst play of the day and all the things that I messed up on this particular edition of The Broken. It's the worst play of the day. We're going to Guatemala. A fan throws a rock onto the field during a stoppage, which leads to this dive. Okay, that's going to lead to a top 10 on Wednesday for sure. Just one big mistake and you blew it. It was a graphic error. We used the 2021 NBA All-Star Game logo, the Indianapolis logo. Indy was originally the host. They moved it to Atlanta. So long.
Where are you from, Jim?
Ireland.
I like your accent. It's tough. Nope. I want to learn how to talk like that.